Hello and welcome back to Football is Life here on WECB, the underground sound of Emerson College. I'm Nathaniel Maymoudis, one of your co-hosts, alongside
Ethan Cooney here. How you guys doing today? Doing all right. It's a nice day to talk about some soccer, talk about the going into the second week of MLS, do a little recap of the first week.
We have Matthew Powell on Zoom. Do you want to say hi, Matt?
Hello. I am tuning in from home with COVID.
Let's start by getting into the Nashville-Seattle game. Didn't go as quite as how I would have, as good as how I would have hoped.
Yeah.
Matt, what are your thoughts on the game?
So I find it kind of funny that Nat can't hear me for this, but this is totally a characteristic game. Nashville went on the road, and the key to this one was the defensive formation. And really, we came into this game and we went for the tie. We high-pressed at the beginning of the first half, the end of the first half, the beginning of the second half, and the end of the second half. And those were our moments to win the game. Every other minute that was not one of those, we were banking on defense and maybe a counter. The goal was to get out of this 1-0-0 or 1-1. But the fatigue from the Seattle players probably proved to be the difference because the goal came late.
Nashville came in doing exactly what was expected. They, from last year, their defense stood strong, and the Sounders played straight into their hands. I don't really like the excuse that the Sounders were tired and that they played midweek, because we made substitutions when they went up 5-0. And so I feel like we should have had a strong team. So I don't, not a fan of that that claim. I was disappointed. I did feel like the team was lacking energy, which and that changed when Leo Chu came into the game. I thought he was the Sounders' best player, but it was really lacking from the Sounders. And then to give up a goal as lame as the one that we did, because like, it was a boring goal, but that's the goal that they won. Nashville should have scored before they actually did. Like, they had so many chances because we gave the ball away. And that was just sloppy play from the Sounders. Do you have any thoughts, Ethan?
Hearing you to talk about this game, it's reminding me of NYCFC's game against LA Galaxy. I know you said that you don't like the excuse of potential fatigue from the Champions League, but I think it's pretty valid, and I think something similar happened to NYCFC, who also lost 1-0 to a late goal in the match. So I think that it's possible that Seattle maybe were just a little fatigued, and Nashville obviously were coming off an off season where they want to get things going and they want to play. So, and it sounds like they know how they want to play. It's very much the Nashville that we know. They did what they do, and it worked better than usual this time, I think.
I feel like this just proves how much better the Western Conference is than the Eastern Conference. Now, Matt, you were just in the Eastern Conference, and now you're in the Western Conference. Do you have any feelings about this transition? I mean, we already talked about how MLS clearly doesn't know how to, like, look at a map.
I think it's interesting that we're headed to the West. I think it will hurt our push for the Supporter Shield if that were ever going to be a possibility. Then this predicament would probably limit our ability to push for that because of all the traveling we have to do and the opening of the season with the eight straight road games. But I do think we're a good enough team to still make the playoffs. And I don't know. It's weird because we head to the West for probably one season. And then when St. Louis joins, we'll probably head back to the East. So I don't know. We're kind of in flux, but we play who we play and we can't pick them. So we just got to beat them.
Yeah. And I would definitely say that they are a playoff contender. Like that's easy. I mean, it's only one game in, but I mean, again, they're a team that is overlooked by the league, mostly because they came in with Inter Miami, and they are the good team. Gary Smith, their coach, he already won an MLS Cup. He knows how to do that. He won an MLS Cup in 2010. With the Rapids.
Yeah, Nashville have definitely won the expansion team battle with Inter Miami. I mean, I know it's only been a couple years, but Inter Miami, especially with all the money that they've had, I don't think MLS fans make enough fun of Inter Miami. I think we should ridicule them more.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like, I guess, with them, because that like they've never been good, like they've always been terrible.
Yeah,
like it just like feels like you're piling on. Like that's like it's easy to hate the Timbers and LAFC.
That's true.
And Atlanta, because like they set like their goals so high, and I would say you can say that about the Sounders too. Our goals are so high, so then when we fall so low, we make so many mistakes, like the Sounders did against Nashville.
That's true.
Then like people are gonna make fun.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't really make a ton of fun of Inter Miami until they came. And played us. Tati scored a brace that game and we won 2-0. But we happened to be sitting near... This is at Red Bull Arena, so we weren't in our usual season ticket spots. And we happened to be near a big group of Miami fans. And they were probably the most annoying fans that I've had to deal with in a really long time at a home game. So I garnered a new level of disrespect for them after that game. So... we should make more fun of Inter Miami.
Okay, we'll try to. We'll definitely try to. I think we should switch to the NYCFC game against the Galaxy. This was a very entertaining game, and honestly, like the Nashville game, like while it was tough to watch, both of the games this week of our teams like were great games. I feel like I have to apologize to the Galaxy fans because like I was talking so much last week about how the Galaxy have no defense, and clearly their coach, former Toronto FC coach, he clearly either listens to our show or like realized that last
season.
Pretty
sure. I think he's a listener. I think he heard us on the show.
Yeah. And he was like, he heard us on Friday and he was like, man, we got a game on Sunday. We got to fix the defense because their defense looked very good on the weekend. And NYCFC just couldn't break him down.
Yeah. I think it's very possible for NYCFC to try and do the same things. I mean, every team does this, really, is they have a formula and they have a style that they try to execute. And sometimes it works incredibly well, and then sometimes a team has done the right work where it doesn't really come off. I mean, I know NYCFC definitely had a couple opportunities this game where we came very close. I know Tati had a header that was sort of like off the back of his head right near the end of the break that was so close to going in, a couple inches. And then, of course, at the end of the game, after Chicharito had scored, Hey Bear had an opportunity to score, and he just missed wide. And, I mean, I would have loved to see him score there. He still has not scored a professional goal since coming back from his ACL injury. And I want to see it happen because he's a really good player, and he's good for the club. He's got a really nice positive attitude, and I hope that attitude can be reflected on the field soon. But as for NYCFC, looking forward to a better game this weekend, I hope. I think we usually, you know, first game of the season, somebody on Twitter was like, all right, I'll see you guys in 6 months when the season starts. And, like, that's pretty true. Like, a lot of the MLS season almost doesn't matter until you really get down to the nitty-gritty playoff deciding times. So I'm not too angry about this. I am obviously upset about the loss, but I'm like, we're fine, I think.
Yeah, and it is true. Like, the season's long, and, like, there is, like, if you have momentum going into the playoffs, you usually are going to do better. Like, there's a, like, the team that comes in first in the playoffs, usually it's because that the person who comes in first going into the playoffs, it's usually because they started out very high in the season, like the Sounders did during last season. And then we had bad form in the playoffs, going into the playoffs, and that led to an early exit. So it's all about getting into form in September.
Yeah, exactly. Like, and we saw this. We saw this happen last year, where NYCFC were kind of going up and down the whole season. It was really strange, because some weeks they would look like the best team in the MLS, and then we went on like that horrific streak of just not winning, and Tati wasn't scoring goals, and then all of a sudden, it just clicked, and we got into like that end of the season form, and we had that momentum going into the playoffs, and it just carried on and on and on. And then we won the MLS Cup. So, you know, that's how it goes.
Yeah, 2016 Sounders in last place in the Western Conference, and then we end up coming in, and then we end up winning the cup.
Yeah. And against Toronto, which makes it oh so much better.
Yeah. Yeah. It's definitely true. So we have to talk about the two referee decisions.
Oh, yes.
In this game, let's hear from how you were feeling like watching back.
Yes, I was unable to watch this game live. And I'm almost glad that I wasn't able to, because I think if I was watching it live, that I would have burst a blood vessel or something yelling at my computer screen, because this call is ridiculous. The call we're referring to, I think maybe around the 30 something minute, around there.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah, NYCFC had a free kick. Maxi Morales was sending it into the box, and a foul was called. It was a foul on Malti Amundsen against Chicharito, saying that he like pushed Chicharito down and all that. And that call in itself is a wrong call, because I know you and I were looking at the footage, and you can really kind of see Chicharito is like instigating all of that contact and is really pulling Malti down so that Malti will fall on top of him and look like Malti committed the foul.
I don't even know how you can say he committed the foul. Because how does he fall on top of Chicharito if Chicharito doesn't fall him down?
Seriously.
He doing like a trust fall? Because like that's like the only thing. And like, why would he be doing that? Like, he doesn't, like, the NYCFC player doesn't make any. He's trying to go towards the ball, which is in
seriously.
Front of him. So
Chicharito sells it so well. Like, he knows how to do it. The height difference also helps, because you think that helpless man is so short he couldn't do anything. And then as well, as soon as he falls down, he's got his arms flopping around everywhere so that it looks like, you know, he didn't touch Malti at all. But the really insidious event on that same play is on the far corner of the field. Maxime Cheneau is trying to make an attempt on the ball, and then the LA Galaxy player Araujo, but you know, I'm going to change that. Cheneau wasn't even trying to make an attempt on the ball. He was trying to run towards where the ball is going to be.
Yeah.
Because the ball had like barely even been kicked yet. And Araujo from the LA Galaxy almost like jumps on Cheneau's back and grabs his face from behind and pulls him down to the floor.
It's not exactly like the throwdown that Tim Melia did last year. But
that was amazing.
Because Chenault, like, doesn't really react on the play. Like, on the play, he's like, the referees said after the game, so Joe Dickerson made comments about why they didn't review this call, because he called the foul. VAR said that it was correct, there was no penalty, and he said that it didn't raise to the level of, like, clear and obviously a penalty, which is just beyond me.
What about that is not clear and obvious?
Yeah,
like,
it's very clear. But they said that Chenault was blocking Araujo from getting to the ball, and, like, Chenault, like, he's in the way, but he doesn't like make his body big,
yeah.
And you don't see him, like, backing up. He's walking forward.
Yeah,
He doesn't back up into Araujo. So
yeah.
So the fact that Araujo decides to grab him when it seems like Araujo is supposed to be covering Tati.
Yeah.
Why is he pulling down this guy when he should just be focusing on getting back on his mark? Because he's already about 6 yards behind. So that is a penalty, 100%.
Yeah.
The other one is also a penalty. I don't see how you could also say, like, How Chicharito is showing that he's been fouled, because every angle that I see this play, it doesn't look like he's being fouled.
It's so ridiculous.
So the refs and honestly, I might say both of them, to me, could be a red card. Like, if you could give a red card for these...
Yeah, the Araujo one is definitely a red card. Like, I feel like there's no question about that.
Yeah.
You can't put your hands on a player's face like that. There was the Kyoto red card this weekend where he kind of just punched a player's stomach, and that was a red card. I don't see how... If that's violent conduct, then so is, like, reaching around and grabbing somebody's face and hurting their eye. Like, I think Chenault announced that he was actually, actually hurt by this incident.
Yeah, the refs have to know when, like, they need to sometimes look at players' expressions. We've got people sent off when, like, someone's hand touches someone's head, and it's just because, like, they're, like, playing around. Like, the players will have giant smiles on their faces,
yeah,
and then they still get sent off. And it's like, in MLS, players should know by now, if you touch someone's face, you get a red card. It's just how the game
works
in MLS.
Apparently not when you're an LA Galaxy player.
Yeah, that is true. In other leagues, that's not really true. If you touch someone's face, you don't always get sent off. It's true here.
Yeah.
For those calls... And the Orlando one, the player got... I believe that was a VAR check. Like, the VAR told him to take a look at the punching. Matt, do you want to weigh in on all these referee decisions? Matt, you still with us?
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. I think that the missed PK call from the NYFC and LA Galaxy game is the worst call. It should be a PK. He drags him down, and ultimately it was a 3-point decision to not make that call.
Yeah.
So it was wrong, and it was a big deal. And I will say that the one saving grace is that these two teams play in different conferences. If this were to happen in a game between two teams that play in the same conference, this could be a 6-point decision when it comes to end of the year standings.
That's true.
There's a saving grace there, but not much of one. And it's nothing to do with a good decision.
Yeah, I think it's a great point you make. While you can, obviously this decision would have changed the game. However, I'm sorry, Ethan, NYCFC did not deserve to win this game. Like, the LA Galaxy improved so much from how they played last year, and they 100% deserved to win this game. So if NYC had walked out with that call. Yes, it's the correct call, but it would have been but NYCFC should have been walking out being like, we got outplayed and we got lucky.
No, yeah, we should be. I mean, I'm not even saying that if we had gotten that red card, it would be definitely a different game, because then that's like 70 more minutes of play with or 60 more minutes of play with where LA Galaxy only have 10 players, but it's not a guarantee that we would have won. NYCFC have failed to win when the other team has a red card before. But yeah, there's no question that we should definitely be playing better. And we don't really even have injury excuses or anything like that. Our only player that's out is Anton Tinnerholm, still with his Achilles injury. And while that is still a big loss, I think Tavon Gray is still a really good option at right back. So I don't really think we have many excuses to make, even with CCL, which we didn't rest as many players as the Sounders did, and maybe we should have. And I know Ronnie Dyla, before that second leg CCL game, was talking about how he was really focusing on that game and not necessarily the LA game, and that he was going to like wait until the second leg was over to focus on the LA game. Maybe he should have focused on it just a little bit more. But honestly, at the end of the day, I feel like we could focus all of our energy on CCL for like the first however many months of the season. And as long as we're not in the bottom half of the table, we could still probably make the playoffs.
I think it's interesting to note that all the MLS teams that played in CCL did lose their MLS match, except, and obviously that does not include the Revolution. I mean, they tied, even though they were supposed to have a game. I think it's something that no one who doesn't play soccer professionally can understand. Like, when I think about, like, I don't know how much running like soccer players actually really have to do, because it doesn't seem that hard for me to think like, oh, if you played 60 minutes on the weekday, why you can't play 80 minutes on the weekend?
Right.
Like that, like, these are people who are super fit and they can't play like at the same time. Like, we just don't know like how much training they're really doing, and it's like how it just shows how fit you have to be to play this sport.
Yeah,
and
I mean, I would say that soccer athletes are probably the most like in shape athletes out there.
That's a bold statement.
Bold statement, and I know a lot of like mostly American sports fans would probably like yell at me for saying that, but I don't know. I think it's true. I don't really think there's another sport out there that involves just that much constant effort.
Yeah, it is great that the ball never really stops in soccer.
Yeah.
And you have to keep running. But it's hard to say. It's hard for me to say, like, it's the you have to be the most athletic, because, like, when you look at soccer players compared to other athletes, like, soccer players look like normal people. Like, if you see a football player or a basketball player in person, you know that they're a football player or a basketball
player. That's
true,
but I also feel like when you're a football or a basketball player, you play, what, like 5 minutes at a time? Like in basketball, playing a lot of minutes is like 45 minutes, which is one half of soccer. Maybe that's a false equivalency, but I don't know. Soccer players don't get enough respect in terms of their athleticism, I think.
Okay, I think it's time that we transition. Let's go to some music. Now, I think it's fair to say that Greg Vanney was a genius when it came to his tactics in the first game. Let's go to some music.
Think I'm stupid? Do you think I'm batshit crazy having you on my mind? Do you think I'm helpless? My algebra gon' equal you every time. Do you think I'm calling? Do you think I'm calling out your name every night? Girl, I've fallen for you.
What you say? Oh my God, baby, don't you see? I got everything. idea.
Listening to WECB FM, the underground sound of Emerson College. And after talking about what happened last week in MLS,
got some international news.
Got some international news. Some not as happy stories in the world of soccer right now. And we got to discuss Russia has been banned from international competition over what's going on with Ukraine these days. It took FIFA some time to act. It took UEFA some time to act. They were sort of waiting to see what countries who were supposed to play against Russia was doing. But now they have been kicked out. They haven't said how long, but right now it means that they cannot compete in the playoff rounds for the World Cup. And the Russia women's team also cannot compete in the European championship in the summer. Matt, what are your thoughts on this decision?
It's a punitive measure, and you should take a punitive measure here. I just checked, tried to catch up on the most recent part of the news. Russia plans to appeal the ban. We'll see how that goes. So it's a developing story, but this is a good decision.
Yeah, definitely. Ethan, do you have thoughts on this announcement?
I mean, I think I'd have to agree that it's a good decision. It sucks for the Russian players who now will miss out on international football. But Matt's right, it's a punitive measure, and it's one that should be taken. Anything to get Russia to stop what they're doing will help. Because, it's not what the world needs right now. It's not good. It's bad. So very nuanced take on my part, yep. But yeah.
Yeah, we're definitely thinking of the people in Ukraine. It's unfortunate because we want to just be able... football is life. We want everyone to be able to enjoy football. And it sucks when one team has to be excluded from the competition. But unfortunately, it is the right decision. have some also sad news in the world of soccer. Do you want to take that away, Ethan?
Yeah. Yes. A college player, Katie Meyer, recently died by suicide. A very tragic event. I think something that often is overlooked in sports communities is mental health issues. There's a lot of play through the pain. Usually that's meant for physical pain, which is bad enough, but it can also account for emotional pain. And just in general with sports, even with women's sports, like Katie, there's a lot of toxic ideals baked into it. About what you can and cannot do, and nobody should ever feel like they should take their own life. And it's an incredibly sad event, and it's not something that any of us ever want to happen. So I want to throw out the number there for the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, 1-800-273-TALK or 8255. That's 1-800-273-8255. If you're, to any of our listeners, if you're out there, if you're ever feeling this way, please know that there will be people in your corner. There's always this number you could call. This is something we don't ever want to happen, because it's never something that should happen, and it's really unfortunate. And our thoughts, and we're sending love to Katie's family and her teammates.
Yes, well said. Definitely a tragic event, and we are thinking of Katie. Let's play some more music, and we'll get on with the show.
Tonight I swear
Welcome back to Football is Life. You're listening to WECB-FM, the underground sound of Emerson College. Football is Life.
Football is Life.
We want to remind you, we'll remind you now, please follow the show on Instagram.
Yeah.
Football is Life, .WECB. You can find us on Instagram.
Yeah, check us out.
And then also, if you missed any portion of the show or you want to share with your friends, you can listen to the show on Spotify.
Spotify.
Football is Life.
Football is Life, especially on Spotify, guys. Let's talk about week two. Let's get into some, you know, previews and predictions.
Let's start with your team, Ethan.
Yeah.
NYCFC. Coming off the loss. Against LA, and now you get to play Canada as your next two games are against Vancouver and Montreal. But you also have CCL in the middle of those. How are you feeling going into all those games?
Well, going into tomorrow's game against Vancouver, I'm feeling pretty confident. I would love for it to be a home game. It unfortunately is not. But I mean, we are coming off a loss, but Vancouver is coming off a 4-0 loss to Columbus opening day. That's pretty big. Four different goal scorers for Columbus there.
Clearly Vancouver was not told that the season started. They definitely, it looked like they didn't show up.
Yeah.
And that
red
sort of
card for Vancouver as well for Jake Nervinsky.
And he gets a second yellow, and it was just like a super easy call. He was on a yellow card, clearly pulls his player back
right
at midfield.
That
was just a dumb play. That's again
like terribly dumb play.
He just forgetting that the season started.
Yeah, made even dumber by with his reaction, because he was like, what? And it's like, I mean, come on, dude. Like, so I feel fine going against Vancouver. And then after Vancouver, we've got the game in Connecticut against Comunicaciones. I probably, totally butchered that pronunciation. CCL quarterfinal leg one. I'll be at this game. I'll be there in person, thanks to spring break.
Nice.
And yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I do think that this team is better than our last opponent. But once again, we should probably win.
They're still not DMX. The feel I have about CCL, if you lose to someone who's not League MX, it's a failure. It's more like it. Like, even though, like, I feel like MLS should be able to compete with League MX, and we obviously we can beat them at this moment. The only thing that's acceptable to go out in this tournament is if you lose to League MX.
Yeah,
and
they just have a whole other like style and energy to their play that the MLS just does not have, and so it's always
faster.
It's always a clash when teams of those two leagues play. And then after that first like game, we've got Montreal in the home opener, which I will also be at in person. Hopefully,
is that game at Yankee Stadium?
Finally? I believe so. Yeah, Yankee Stadium home opener. It's going to be a great day. I believe it's at 1 p.m., so the sun's going to be out.
Has NYCFC made an announcement about their stadium? I mean, now that it seems like the MLB season isn't going to happen, do they get to play their homes there, or are the Yankees like, if we're not there, then you can't play there?
Yeah, I don't really know, because I know that we already have our stadiums like scheduled for the games of this season. Like, we know which games are at Yankee Stadium. We know which games are at Citi Field. We know which games are up in New Jersey at Red Bull Arena. So we'll see what happens. I would love it if every game that is not at Yankee Stadium could become a Yankee Stadium game. That would be absolutely gorgeous. But yeah, we'll see what happens. I personally don't really know anything about the MLB or that situation. I really only kind of loosely follow
you?
It. Yeah.
Why would you? It's not football. And yeah. Football is life.
And football is life. Baseball is not life.
Exactly.
No
one says that.
Nobody says that. Nobody says baseball is life.
What do you think your record is going to be after these, in the time of our next show? Because there will be a 1 week break from Football is Life. Because we also have lives.
We do also have lives along with football. But, you know, we'll maybe be active on our Instagram and maybe you'll see our opinions there.
Yeah.
Footballislife.wcb.
How are you feeling about these four games? Like, do you think 2-2? Do you think you're going to win all four? How are you feeling?
I think we'll beat Vancouver. I think we'll win all three games. I do. That's kind of bold. And if we don't win one of them, it's going to be the Vancouver game tomorrow. I can see that as being the trap game.
I was going to say Montreal, because Montreal is also playing in CCO. So that's going to be an interesting game.
That's interesting, yeah. I don't know. I don't really see us... I don't see us losing at home in the home opener game. Coming back after we've won the
that's
MLS
fair.
Cup.
Yeah, they want to put on a show for the fans.
I just don't really see it happening. I think the fan support's going to be awesome. I think it's going to be wild.
Yeah, get to put up that banner.
Oh, yeah. Oh, are we going to get one of those?
Oh, definitely. You're definitely going to get
them. I
didn't
even think about that.
Yeah.
I'm so excited.
I mean, like, you know, like some of us have already seen like two of those got put up. Yeah. So I don't think it's that special, but I mean, like...
It's true. Yeah.
Speaking of like new stuff being put up, Nashville's new stadium is coming around, and Nashville has two more road games since that's not finished build yet. Matt, no CCLs, you only got two games in between the time. How are you feeling about your next two games?
I'll be quick about this. We play a upper middle table of the team in Minnesota, and we play a lower middle of the table team in FC Dallas. I say if we come away from this with any less than 4 points, it's a disappointment. I'd love six, but I doubt it with how we play. So I'm going to say that we'll probably come away from this with 4 points, a win and a draw. And another thing, I'm super excited about the stadium. It looks so good. They were putting in the grass the other day, and I'm excited to attend some games over the summer.
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks so sick. For a team that, I mean, it sort of looks like the same as the Columbus Crew's new stadium, except it looks even better than that one.
Yeah,
like, I love the yellow, the yellow mixed in seats. Like,
it's also not named lower.com field. Yeah. So it's definitely an advantage.
Have they announced the name for the stadium yet, Matt?
The name is pending, so we'll see.
Okay. So
what a strange name for a stadium.
Okay.
Sorry, that's a bad joke.
Okay. So it actually could be worse. We just don't know yet.
Even lower.com field, it'll be called.
Now I know that you're being optimistic. I feel like you're being a little optimistic Matt, about these games. I feel like Nashville should win both of these. Has a really good chance. I think they could definitely win both of these games. The Sounders, out of their first three games, was definitely their toughest opponent. Minnesota hasn't looked didn't look very good in their first game, and same thing with Dallas. I think Nashville's a better team. I think Nashville should, when we come back, they should be in first place with 9 points. Do you have any thoughts about Nashville, Ethan?
I don't have a lot of thoughts. Yeah. I think Nashville are just going to become that team that's like always kind of mildly successful, and they'll have those years where they are incredibly successful. But I get the feeling that they're always just going to be a solid team, and that's kind of how things are looking.
But then, like, not win the cup, so sort of like New England, like they're
maybe
a team that's like overlooked. Like, yeah,
maybe.
It seems like they're sort of already like that. Like, they're good, but like no one really cares. It's sort of the same way with like the Union and the Revolution. Like they've had good seasons, but they have not a lot of silverware. But I don't know. There's no new team. They could definitely turn stuff around, get an MLS Cup soon.
It's true. It could happen. I mean, Mukhtar is insane. He is really quite good.
I do think the Sounders shut him down in the first game. So I'm expecting with teams that aren't as good as the Sounders that he will have a big impact.
Yeah, honestly, similar with Mukhtar, how you mentioned, you know, the Sounders shut him down. I think it's honestly, I see a comparison or a similarity with Castellanos for NYCFC, where we do have these star players who do tend to get things done, but because of that reputation, every team we play is going to be gunning for that player. So all of the players around them need to step up and really become a bigger part of the offense. And I think we could say the same thing for both Nashville and NYCFC, maybe a little less for NYCFC, but I am biased. It's a biased take.
And then finally, the Sounders. The Sounders also have CCL games. We have to play a Liga MX opponent, so it's definitely going to be a little stressful over spring break for Nat. Hopefully it doesn't... Hopefully when we get back, I am not super depressed because the team has kicked into gear. The team has to start playing with energy. I'm hoping in the Sounders next game that we see Leo Chu start with the midweek game coming. I think we're going to rest players for this game against RSL. The Sounders have pretty much their entire life struggled when we play in RSL. Maybe having Albert Rusnak will help us there. But
he knows it.
I think this is going to be like a very close game. I'm thinking I'm going to say Sounders are going to win 1-0. But it probably won't be pretty. I definitely like to see Leo Chu start. RSL played a 0-0 tie in their first game. So I'm not expecting...
That's a very RSL opening game.
Yeah, I'm not really expecting that much from this game.
Yeah.
And then the Sounders' other game, coming back home, we get to play the Galaxy. The Galaxy, I've been praising them. It was just like last year. The Galaxy's first two games, they won both games. We're talking about the announcers are talking about them being the team that's going to win MLS Cup this year. I expect that's going to happen since I think the Galaxy are going to beat Charlotte this week. So I think they're going to be coming off two wins. Hopefully we can shut them down again and make Chicharito didn't do nothing. Last time Chicharito came to Seattle, he did absolutely nothing as the Sounders beat the Galaxy 3-0. So both of these games seem tough. And because I think we're going to go for CCL, I think we're going to tie both games.
Both games?
I think, and it hurts me, I can see us losing to the Galaxy. Hopefully that means that we just beat Leon. Like, CCL is what I'm focused on now. And while losing to the Galaxy would be so annoying, especially if Chicharito scores, I think that might happen.
Chicharito hat trick.
I think that might happen.
I know. I don't.
Yeah.
Chicharito's annoying. I have a newfound dislike for him.
Do you have any thoughts about where you see the Sounders going? Going right now.
I mean, in my MLS experience, the Sounders have always been a good team.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I never see them. I never really think of them as anything less. Anything less than a playoff contender?
Yeah, we're still always underrated, even though we've had the best history out of any team.
That is a bold statement. The LA Galaxy does have 5 MLS Cups. But I think your assessment of the Sounders for this week could be pretty accurate.
We just need to wake up. Like, play with the energy. We play with energy that I know we have. The fans get behind the team. When the team's excited, then we're unstoppable.
That's how I feel about NYCFC too.
That's how I think any fan feels when a goal goes in and like a switch turns on and goes electric. Matt, do you have any final thoughts that you want to say about this week in MLS? Do you have any thoughts moving forward, we got Charlotte playing LA. The MLS attendance record is going to get shattered. Do you have any thoughts about before we take a 1 week break?
Yeah, this is probably something we could talk about when we come back. Yeah. But Zimmerman's going to win Defensive Player of the Year, and Mukhtar is going to win MVP.
Okay.
That's bold.
Bold statement.
That's bold.
Bold statement. Well, yeah, whatever you have to talk about, we will make season award predictions moving forward. I'm happy that we talked for so long. We didn't have to give any time to Carlos Vela this week. Oh, damn. I said his name.
You said his name.
That's unfortunate. But football is life.
Football is life. Greg Vanney, thanks for listening as always.
Exactly. Let's wrap this show up with one more song. Again, if you missed any part, you can listen to the show on Spotify. Follow us on Instagram at footballislife.wecb. Songs from the Smart Fridge. I don't know. It might be coming up next if the dude's here. but tune in 2 weeks. We are gone next week.
Have a good weekend, everybody. Football is life.
But they made me stronger. You can call me runner. Freedom is power. Every time I let loose, I get this situation. I'm sorry, Miss Officer. Now take me to the station. Always tucked up in the middle. Put my head inside a pillow till I'm feeling like bum 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 bum. Check you out, head up in the clouds. Nothing in this life is ever bringing me down. She said, Don't you ever
run from my love, but you still
run. Incredible.